Harper Via and Harper Audio present The Prophet and the Idiot, a novel by Jonas Jonasson, translated from the Swedish by Rachel Wilson Broyles. Performed by Peter Kenny.
2011. When this tale begins, Barack Obama was President of the United States, Ban Ki-moon headed up the United Nations, and Angela Merkel had 10 years left of what was already a 6-year stint as Chancellor of Germany. Russia had a president whose name hardly anyone remembered, yet everyone knew it was acting Prime Minister Putin who ruled there. The Arab Spring swept across northern Africa, led by hundreds of thousands of people who were sick of corruption and sham democracy, and who had convinced themselves change was possible. An earthquake in the Pacific Ocean caused a wave as tall as a 5-story building to crash upon the coast of Japan, destroying everything in its path, including the Fukushima nuclear power plant. Azerbaijan won the Eurovision Song Contest in front of a few hundred million viewers. But those numbers were nothing compared to the 2 billion who had, only a short time earlier, tuned in for the wedding of England's Prince William to Kate Middleton. All while the United States found and shot Osama bin Laden without any viewers at all. The age-old border dispute between Thailand and Cambodia flared up that year, and faded again temporarily. Running the show in Sweden was Prime Minister Reinfeldt, the leader of the Conservative Moderate Party. He was the man who made the left's most prized issues his own, and in doing so, won 2 elections in a row. In that same country, a half-stupid little brother named Johan suddenly found himself on his own when his older brother, Friedrich, jetted off to Rome to make a diplomat of himself. Their mother had been dead for years, while their father walked along the shores of Montevideo hand in hand with his boyfriend. We'll begin our tale with the half-stupid man. But it won't be long before the whole world is along for the ride, including Obama, Ban Ki-moon, and Putin's Russia. Bon appétit. Jonas Jonasson. Part 1. In the Days Before the End of the World. Chapter 1. Summer 2011. Johan was kind, helpful, and unevenly gifted. There was so much he didn't understand. For instance, he did not, in fact, have the best big brother in the world. They were only 2 years apart in age, but Johan looked up to Friedrich the way a son looks up to his father, like the father neither of them had, although actually they did. A man who had deserted the family before Johan was even born, and who showed up now and then over the years, most recently at their mother's funeral. During the post-service coffee, he gifted his sons the 12.5-room apartment on the swankiest street in Stockholm. He told Friedrich he was proud of him and Johan that maybe it would all work out one day. And then he was gone. The brothers were similar in appearance and total opposites in personality. Big brother had followed in his absent father's footsteps, already on his way to a career in diplomacy with the goal of one day becoming an ambassador. Little brother, meanwhile, was failing at delivering the post. While one was performing well in the diplomacy program at the Ministry for Foreign Affairs, the other made sure to keep the 12.5 rooms in decent condition, since there wasn't much else he was good for. Each evening, Friedrich would plop down in the wingback chair in the library with some important documents, ask Johan to serve him a whiskey, assess his hunger, and decide what time dinner should be served. 7:15, he might say to his brother. And I mean 7:15. Now scram and leave me alone. Johan felt needed and proud to be of use. On the whole, he was content. He found flavours and aromas as exciting as thinking was complicated. Friedrich was rarely, no, make that never, satisfied with the results. But why should he be? Johan was incompetent, and Big Brother was good at constructive criticism. Don't put so much oregano in the sauce, you idiot! He was also meticulous about etiquette. Never serve a Pinot Noir in a Bordeaux glass. How many times do I have to tell you? Once was enough. The kitchen had been Johan's domain ever since the age of 12, when the mother had become too ill to get out of bed. 6 years later, she died of something in Latin Johan could never remember. Waiting on Friedrich began as a game, and the game continued long after they were grown. Friedrich called it gentry and servants. One of them was the gentry, the other the servants. If the poor servant boy failed to obey or forgot to say, yes, my lord, or no, my lord, they switched places and the game went on. Friedrich was the best at everything, except this. He messed up every single time he was the servant and hardly ever got to be the one who served his brother. When the day of Friedrich's move abroad arrived and everything was turned upside down, Johann had, with very few exceptions, each lasting barely a minute, been the servant boy for 15 years in a row. "You're too smart for me, that's all there is to it," said Friedrich. "Now, go get my two suitcases from storage. Then you can iron my shirts and pack my things. But don't forget the beef tenderloin in the oven. We said gorgonzola, right? I'm getting hungry." "Yes, my lord. Yes, my lord. No, my lord. And yes, my lord. And by the way, forget the beef tenderloin? Not a chance. The temperature had to be just right. Roast at 110 degrees, remove when the core temperature reaches 50, rest on a platter to 54.5. That left 11 minutes to finish setting the table." What awaited was Friedrich's first overseas post as a diplomat. Big Brother had a lot to think about before the big move. With a lump in his throat, Johann braced himself to be left on his own in the luxury flat on Strandvägen. But apparently, Friedrich was too kind-hearted to let that happen. He'd sold the 12.5 rooms and used the proceeds to buy an RV for his little brother, with an extra well-equipped kitchen. Johann was also given a prepaid bank card. The PIN was 1235. Friedrich had picked it himself so that even you can't forget it. The bank wouldn't let me do 1234. 1234, Johann repeated. 1235, you idiot, said Friedrich. He had loaded the card with 50,000 kroner and announced that from that day forward, Johann must be an adult and strike out on his own. "Yes, my lord," said Johann, afraid of the unknown but grateful for the help he had received. As if this weren't enough, Friedrich had taken care of selling all the furnishings that had been passed down through their father's Livienholt line ever since anyone could remember. There was a grand piano, 8 Persian rugs, just as many Renaissance paintings, china bureaus, crystal chandeliers, cabinets and mirrors. The auctioning firm said that altogether it was a categorically stupendous lot. Johann heard this, but had a hard time understanding difficult words. Friedrich explained that it meant the firm expected the proceeds would cover the cost of Friedrich's flight to Rome. With that, almost everything had been taken care of. All that was left was for Big Brother to instruct Johann about the RV. He would need an electrical hookup to charge the batteries, otherwise he couldn't prepare meals. There were RV parks here and there around Stockholm. Friedrich had booked him a spot at one in Fisksätra. "It was expensive as shit," as Friedrich said. As thanks for his help, he demanded to be driven to the airport. Before they'd gone anywhere, the diplomat-to-be decided it was best he do the driving himself. By then, Johann had spent 2 minutes familiarising himself with the steering wheel. Little Brother thought the chauffeur switch was a good idea. Driving a car was just as tricky as practically everything else. When they reached the international terminal, Friedrich said a word or two Johann didn't understand, followed by goodbye and good luck, and he took his two suitcases and disappeared. The man who knew he was worthless was all alone in life for the first time. He decided to start by driving all the way to Fisksätra, as good a way as any to learn how the vehicle worked. It changed gears on its own, that was good, and there were only 2 pedals to keep track of, not 3. Things would probably be fine as long as he didn't think about anything else while he drove, and he didn't expect he would need to. But for that very reason, he missed a lane change on the way towards Stockholm and took an exit he shouldn't have, only to discover he'd ended up outside a shopping centre. Oh, perfect! Thus, the kitchen of the RV was fully stocked when Johann finally managed to find his way to the RV park southeast of the city. Expensive as shit, Friedrich had called it. That was surely true. But even so, Johann allowed himself to admit that it looked a bit shabby. It was the size of a football pitch, more or less, more mud than grass, a few power poles here and there, a sign listing everything that was not allowed. Johann didn't have time to read it because he had to concentrate on parking properly. The place was deserted, aside from one lone camper not far off near a slope. People probably preferred to be out on the road in the middle of summer like this, Johann thought. But he should not have thought at all. He already had the accelerator pedal to think of, and the one right next to it, and the steering wheel. Time to turn that so that he would stop approaching the camper, and time to brake. But almost everything was so hard. A stroke of bad luck found him, or however that saying went. The lone camper happened to be parked in exactly the wrong spot, and the camper was coming closer even though it was standing still. Johann realised that this was because he himself was still moving forward. The accelerator pedal and brake pedal looked identical. The gas was on the right, the brake on the left. But which way was right and left? After managing to make it all the way here from the airport, many kilometres away, urgent was suddenly the only way Johan could describe the situation. He had to brake. He guessed wrong. The RV leapt forward. He guessed again. Right this time. So it wasn't a serious crash. But still, the RV did run into the back of the only other vehicle in the whole field, but it was only a bump, and Johan had managed to stop. The camper, however, began to roll, and it picked up speed down the slope. 1 meter, 2, 5, 10, perhaps, before a lone tree stood in the way. That's not good, said Johan. But in fact, you might say that it was. Chapter 2. Friday, August the 26th, 2011. 12 days to go. The doomsday prophet secured a hook to the ceiling. She was in a grim mood, with a rope tightly looped around her neck. Only the very last step remained, kicking the stool out from under her. After all, no one would listen to her, and there were only 12 days left before the end of the world. She might as well do without them. She had run the calculations again and again and yet again. She made her living as a schoolteacher, but only so she could afford food and rent while she pursued her research in astrophysics. The students who came with the job were a necessary evil. Once her doomsday calculations were complete, she'd tried to get in touch with the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences. She had worked on the 64-step equation for 9 years and wanted someone to confirm her findings. Not that it was necessary, and certainly not because it would have any effect on the outcome, but she wanted some kind of acknowledgement. The Academy had not responded to her emails or letters. When she contacted them by phone, her call was forwarded so many times that she eventually ended up back where she'd started. Her only remaining option had been to walk into the premises unannounced and demand a meeting with the chairman, or the permanent secretary, or anyone other than the security guard. In response to her demands, someone called the police, who didn't have time to come. The security guard took matters into his own hands and guided her outside and down the long set of steps, where there must have been 20 university students hanging out. Some of them looked frightened as the guard came by with a firm grip on the intruder's arm. Others were surprised. What she remembered most of all was the slightly indulgent smiles from students who all had one thing in common. They would soon be dead. Everyone would soon be dead, before she could share what she knew with a single soul. So, what was the point? In the end, what was the point of anything? The prophet counted the days she had lived, including today. The total was 11,052. Each and every one of them, as far back as she could remember, had been nothing but miserable. No one had ever understood her. No one had loved her. Had she ever even loved anyone, aside from Malte Magnusson in secondary school? That boy with his lovely smile and gentle manner. A lovely smile. Essentially, that was all he had given her. And a vague sense that maybe he wanted more but wasn't brave enough to ask. Not much of a love story. Then 6 years passed, plus another 9 of calculations that were now complete. There was no denying her conclusion. The prophet could say nearly down to the minute when the atmosphere would collapse. She didn't even bother to give notice at her job. She just stopped showing up, sure that the students didn't mind in the least. She also didn't bother to pay the rent. Not that she needed to save money. What good would it be when everything froze to ice? It was simply pointless. But she was evicted sooner than she'd counted on, and it was cold to be without housing, especially at night. She had found the camper in a classified ad, bought it as is. It would need to undergo inspection before it could be driven away from the campground where it sat. Inspected, she thought. In light of what she knew, each detail seemed so trivial. Her decision began to take shape. 20 days left. Miserable day. 19 days left. Miserable day. 18 days left. Why should she go on, if the rest of existence was only going to be more of the same? If instead she put an end to herself, wouldn't that be a tiny win? Wouldn't she be conning the world out of one last drop of absolute shit in some way? The idea took root and brought her peace. She purchased a hook, rope, and stool, and was seconds from stepping into eternity, 12 days ahead of everyone else, when there was a sudden jolt. An initial, dreadful thought ran through her head. Had her calculations been 12 days off? Surely that wasn't possible. The hook came loose from the ceiling and skidded under the counter. The camper began to roll. No, this was something else. The prophet lost her balance, fell off what was meant to be the suicide stool, and landed softly on her own sofa. The camper's journey continued for a few seconds, but soon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.